I wasn't sure if I was getting a green light there or not. Here we go. Well, God is good. Oh, that was weak. I know it's early in the morning. We hadn't had our coffee, but let's try that again. God is good. And all the time. Amen. Do have two or three things I want to mention this morning before we begin. First and foremost, I want to remind everyone that the Surrey Baptist Association's annual meeting will be tomorrow night at Mount Carmel Baptist Church in Mount Airy. Afternoon session will begin at 4 p.m. There'll be a dinner, I believe, at 6, if I'm not mistaken. And then the evening session will be at 7 p.m. I didn't realize this, but Brother Tim Burton will be preaching the evening session. So he's talking about, I think, was it something about Acts? An Acts, not the book of Acts, but an Acts. So I think that's what he was talking about, preaching. And if I'm not mistaken, I think it was on the Song of Solomon or something. I may have the two messages confused. But anyhow, it should be a good time tomorrow. Also, want to let everybody know that Osir Martin, he came to receive Christ a few weeks ago. We're going to have his baptism, God willing, next Sunday at the 11 o'clock service. I want to take a moment to thank everyone for the cards and gifts that you gave us, not only for Pastor Appreciation Day, but also for my birthday. I really appreciate that. And we had a wonderful, was it apple Dutch pie? Is that it, Rolene? Apple raisin, it is good. Bob, you the man, I'm telling you. You the man. So wonderful, wonderful. And we thank you guys so very, very much. And so I was telling Jason, he was here with us last Sunday, and I saw Rolene. I said, that's one of the sweetest ladies you'll ever meet right there coming up. And she gave him a big old hug. So Rolene, we thank you for your ministry with Bob as well. And just excited to see what God is doing as we move forward for the kingdom of God. We're going to ask you to turn your book, your Bible, your copy of the Word of God to Acts chapter 4, verses 1 through 22. This is continuing the sermon series that we've been going through, talking about evangelism, why evangelize, or how do we evangelize. And as we're going to see here in a few moments, when I think about evangelism and I think about the power we see coming from Christ, as I think about the impact that it makes, we have to ask ourselves the question, do we have the power to evangelize? Do we have the power to share the gospel of Christ? So we're going to look at Acts chapter 4, verses 1 through 22, and we'll encourage everyone to please stand in honor of the reading and hearing of God's precious holy word, Acts chapter 4, verses 1 through 22. Now, this is taking place after the resurrection has taken place. Peter and John, in chapter 3, they're going to the temple. They're proclaiming, they're preaching in the name of Christ. And so we're going to see that they come into some issues with the Sanhedrin. Now, how many of you know if you preach the gospel, if you preach for the Lord, you do a work for the Lord, you might get in trouble from time to time. Amen? You might get in trouble from time to time because God has a way of changing our perspectives. He has a way of moving us into uncomfortable situations at times for His glory and for His honor. Now, in chapter 4, verse 1, now as they spoke to the people, the priests, the captain of the temple, and the Sadducees who don't believe in the resurrection, and that's why they're sad, you see, as the old cliche goes, being greatly disturbed that they taught the people and preached in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And they laid hands on them and put them in custody until the next day, for it was already evening. However, many of those who heard the word believed, and the number of the men came to be about 5,000 people. Now, understand this. Jesus never promised that your walk's going to be an easy road. Amen? But if you're faithful to Him, you will see fruit eventually. Now, they were locked up. They were jailed. They become jailbirds. Now, I mean, if you think about this, how many preachers do you know were in jail? how many preachers you know do that? But they were placed in jail because of the witness of the gospel. And it came to pass, in verse 5, on the next day, that the rulers, elders, and scribes, as well as Annas, the high priest, Caiaphas, John, and Alexander, and as many as were of the family of the high priest, were gathered together at Jerusalem. And when they had set them in the midst, they asked, by what power or by what name have you done this? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, Rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if we this day are judged for a good deed done to a helpless man. Now, by the way, there was a healing that took place. Peter healed a lame man in the area in the name of Jesus. If we this day are judged for a good deed done to a helpless man, by what means he has been made well, let it be known to you all that to the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified. Now, that's bold right there. Amen? They're speaking to the very same people that crucified Jesus. And they said, by the authority of Jesus of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God also raised from the dead, by him this man stands here before you whole. Now notice he didn't take a personal credit for what happened. He said, Jesus of Nazareth, he's the one that healed this man. I didn't heal him. It's through the power of Jesus. This is the stone which has been rejected by you builders, which has become the chief cornerstone. Nor is there salvation in any other. Now that's not popular today, is it? What did he just say? There's no salvation in any other name but by the name of Jesus Christ. For there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Now when they heard the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men, this does not mean that they were stupid. This means that they didn't go to the Jerusalemite approved schools. You see, I'm going to Liberty. Okay, I realize in some places that's not going to be an approved school because it's a conservative school. So that's what he's talking about. He's not saying that they were ignorant men. He said they didn't go to our approved schools. Okay, they marveled and they realized that they had been with Jesus. And seeing the man who had been healed standing with them, they could say nothing against it. But when they commanded them to go aside out of the council, they conferred among themselves, saying, What shall we do to these men? For indeed that a notable miracle has been done through them is evident to all who dwell in Jerusalem, and we cannot deny it. But so that it spreads no further among the people, let us severely threaten them, and from now on they speak to no man in this name. So they called them and commanded them not to speak at all or teach in the name of Jesus. And Peter and John answered and said to them, Whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you more than to God, you judge. For we cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. So then they had further threatened them. They can't do anything with these guys. You see what's going on here? So, well, maybe we threaten them. Well, it didn't work. Well, maybe we'll do this to them. Didn't work. They said, are we going to listen to you or are we going to listen to God? We're going to listen to God. So do with us as you please. We're going to listen to God. Because the people, for they had glorified God for what they'd been done. For the man was over 40 years old on whom this miracle of healing had been performed. Dear kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we pray that you would grant us boldness. The boldness we need to be like Peter and John. To stand before whomever we may need to stand before to preach the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, as we look at the studies and we see the surveys going on, we realize that more and more people are abandoning the church. Just recently, we learned that something like 26% of the American population now claim no affiliation to any religion whatsoever. Lord, the mission field is ready for harvest. It is widened to harvest. Help us to catch that vision, to spread the gospel of Christ to our friends, to our neighbors, yes, to the utmost part of the world, but help us begin right here in our community, in our area, and share the gospel of Christ with a lost and dying world. So many times, Lord, we ask, what's the solution to the school shootings? What's the solution to this turmoil we have in our nation? And we know that the solution is found in you, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Fill us with your Spirit, Lord. Help me to speak the words that need to be spoken. Give us eyes to see, ears to hear, and hearts that will be that will apply these truths and be better for it. For it's in Jesus' name we ask all these things. Amen and amen. You may be seated. All right. This doesn't go along with the comic strip. I am getting hot, so I'm going to have to shed this thing. All right, as a kid, they had several good cartoons on when I was a kid. But one of my favorites was He-Man and the Masters of the Universe. Do you remember that one? There's a guy named Prince Adam, and he lived in this place called Castle Grayskull. And when something happened and he needed to evoke a certain type of power, he would pull out his sword, and he would say, "By the power of Grayskull, I have the power." And then he turned into this bodybuilder. Now, it'd be nice if that'd be easy. I was going to bring a little Nerf sword out with me, but I couldn't find the thing, what we did with the thing. But anyhow, wouldn't it be nice if we pull out a sword and say, "I have the power," and turn into bodybuilders and fitness models just like that? That'd be nice. That'd be nice to do that. But he said, "I have the power," and he would come upon the power of Grayskull, and he would become the most powerful person, the most powerful being in all the universe at that point in time. Now, we know that this is a comic. We know that this is a cartoon. However, there is a truth that we also have a sword that grants us great power. And the sword is not made of metal, and no, it's not an earth sword either. But it's in the Word of God. The Bible is our sword, and we have the power. Now, I can't promise you, if you, Roger, hold this thing up, that you're going to turn into Arnold Schwarzenegger. You know, I can't promise you that. I can't promise that that's going to happen. But I can promise you that with this Word and with the Holy Spirit, that we have the power to do great and amazing things because of what Christ is doing in and through our lives. If we've been saved, then we've been filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, in Acts chapter 4, there's a lot of stuff going on. The resurrection has taken place, and we know that Jesus appeared to the disciples alive for over 40 days. When we think of Resurrection Sunday, we think of one Sunday, but it doesn't stop there. If you follow the color of cloths I have on the cross, you'll notice that it stays up there for 40 days. You know why? For 40 days, Jesus appeared to multiple groups of people, performing what Luke says in Acts, infallible proofs to demonstrate that he had risen from the dead, that he had defeated death, and that he had defeated death, hell, and the grave for all eternity. And now we see that 5,000 souls were saved due to the preaching of John and Peter. But we also see that there was a man who was healed, who was lame, who couldn't walk, and that by the power of Jesus Christ, this guy could walk again. Now, when all of this happened, you think that the Sanhedrin would have been happy about that. But we know that they weren't. Amen? We know that they weren't. They had an old sour disposition of their faces. They were angry because this Jesus, they thought they had ended this Jesus movement, but what they had done is they had made it even worse. How many of you know that you can't kill Jesus because Jesus has already defeated death, hell, and the grave? He's already risen, and he has given his church power through the Holy Spirit to do a great work. They were annoyed that they were teaching the people and proclaiming Jesus, in Jesus, the resurrection of the dead. Now, the Pharisees didn't mind the resurrection part because they believed in the resurrection. The Sadducees didn't like either one of them because they didn't like the Jesus, and they didn't like the teaching of the resurrection because they didn't believe in the resurrection. So they had to make a decision. Were they going to live their lives trying to please people, or were they going to live their lives trying to please God? And I say to you, I submit to you this morning that that's the same question we must ask ourselves. Are we going to live our lives being people pleasers or God pleasers? Because how many of you know? Now, I think when you're in the ministry, you have a desire to please people. You want to see people happy. But if there's anything I've learned is that you're never going to make everybody happy. Amen? You're never going to make everybody happy. So if you can make God happy, if God's pleased with you and you're in the will of God and you're where you need to be with God, then it doesn't matter if anybody else is happy or not. That's what Peter and John shows us here in this passage of Scripture. The question is, do we have the power, though, to minister and do a good work for the Lord? Well, there are four reasons I think we can find in this passage of Scripture that shows us that we do indeed have the power to preach in the name of Jesus Christ, to proclaim His name to each and every person we come across. The first thing we see is the believer has the power of authority. The believer has the power of authority in verses 1 through 10. Now you see that they are standing before the Sanhedrin. And the Sanhedrin asked them this question: by whose authority are you proclaiming this message? Now you have to understand, they would allow people to teach in the temple. But in Jewish rabbinic Judaism, you had to come in the name of somebody else. So if you read rabbinic literature, it's very fascinating. I've read some. I think it's Sefaria, S-E-F-A-R-I-A. They have a collection of the Talmud and the Jewish writings, and it reads very interesting. When they say something, they say Rabbi Akiba used to say such and such and such and such, or Rabbi Gamaliel used to say such and such and such and such. So they're coming by the authority of another rabbi. They're coming under the authority of a teacher of some sort. And so when Jesus comes along, they ask him, by whose authority do you preach in the temple? And Jesus says, well, I come by the authority of God the Father. And they say, well, how can you prove that? They didn't like that. Well, we're children of Abraham. We're trying to serve God too. How do we know that you come with the authority of the Father? And Jesus says, well, watch this. You know what he does? He heals the blind. He makes the lame walk. He raises the dead. He does all these miracles to identify and prove the fact that he had the authority of God the Father working in him and through him, that he had God the Father's seal of approval. Well, they didn't like that because he didn't come from their approved schools. They wanted them to come from their schools in Jerusalem. Now, there were schools in Galilee. There were other schools around, but they wanted them to teach in the temple to come from their approved schools so they could control what was being taught and control what was being said. Well, they could never get a hold of Jesus because Jesus always outsmarted them. Jesus was always performing miracles. He was always one or two steps ahead of them. And so they get rid of him. They kill him. They think, well, we've ended this foolishness forever. And then here comes Peter and John. Peter and John come preaching in the temple. And they come preaching in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. And so they say, by whose authority are you preaching in the temple? And they say, we come in the authority of Jesus of Nazareth. And can't you just see the look on their faces? See, I'm in the slapstick comedy. I love to see people's expressions. That's what I get the most amusement from. Can you just imagine the look on their faces? Oh, come on. I thought we ended this thing already. And this thing's still going on? And notice what happens. There's a lame man who's walking, or according to Microsoft Word, that's not a popular word, a disabled man. That's what they say you're supposed to use. No longer lame man, but disabled man. This disabled man was sitting over here. He couldn't walk. And so what do they do? In the power of Jesus of Nazareth, he walks. So they're thinking to themselves, oh my goodness, we can't stop this thing. And there are 5,000 people now who've just received Christ. And so they ask them, by what authority, by whose authority are you doing this? And they say, in the authority of Jesus of Nazareth. And I can see their faces doing all kind of contortions when they figure out that this Jesus movement hasn't stopped, that it's only just begun. Amen? It's only just begun. So the question we have is, do we have the authority? Jesus says that he has been given authority in heaven and on earth to proclaim the message of the gospel, and that authority has been given to you. If you follow Jesus Christ, you have the authority to tell people about Christ. You have the authority to share the gospel message with each and every person you come across. But unfortunately, so many times, I think that we feel that we have to ask permission to do this, to do a work for the Lord. But I think we need a little bit of that boldness of Peter and John once again, to not let anything stand in our way. If God tells us to go do something, go do it. Dr. Jerry Falwell Sr. used to say that if God's telling you to do something, don't wait around asking permission, because it's better to ask forgiveness than to always ask permission, because if you're always asking permission, you're never going to get anything done. Amen? You're never going to get anything done. If you're always asking permission to do something, you're never going to get anything done. But if God is calling you to do something, you know what? Praise the Lord, you already have permission. If God's telling you to go reach someone in your neighborhood, if he's telling you to go down the street and to preach the word of God to somebody, if he's telling you to go and do something for the Lord, God has already given you permission, and you don't need the permission of anyone else. You have the authority of God to reach the lost and dying world. And so many times I think we're so caught up in the red tape that we create for ourselves that we strangle ourselves from doing something powerful for Christ. The believer has the authority to tell others about the Lord Jesus Christ. And rest assured, you may or may not have reverend in front of your name, but you are a minister of God. And God may be laying someone on your mind today that only you could go reach. Only you have the ability to reach that person. The question is, are we going to do it? We have the authority to tell other people about Jesus Christ. And I think many of us could accept that we are far guiltier of not sharing the gospel as we should. Now, I love my Green Bay Packers. And I talk about my Green Bay Packers a lot. But I ask myself the question, do I speak of Jesus as much as I do the Packers? Because the Packers are going to come and go. Jesus Christ lasts forever. So we have the authority to preach the gospel. Secondly, the believer has the power of salvation. Now, that doesn't mean that we have the power to save anyone, but we have the message that saves. We have a message that can transform the lives of people. Now, come January, we're doing a class in apologetics at the Surrey Baptist Association, and we just recently went through the attributes of God, and God's been gnawing at me already to do a series on this. Well, I can't hold it anymore. January, we're going to do a series on the attributes of God, but I don't want to deflate anyone's balloon, but the Bible tells us something very important about God. His name is Yahweh. Which means He is the self-existent one. I hate to deflate anyone's ego this morning, but it's the truth. God doesn't need any one of us. God doesn't need you to survive. In fact, God lived for eternity past without us, and He was just fine. God doesn't need air to breathe. God doesn't need water to drink. God doesn't have a heart that He needs blood to pump through His veins. God didn't have to create us. Now, that'll just really make us feel about that big if you think about it. You think about how big God is. God didn't need us. God didn't have to make us. God didn't have to love us. God most certainly didn't have to save us. In fact, God would be justified if He sent every single one of us to hell. You know that? He'd have been justified if He did just that. God didn't have to make us. He doesn't have to save us. He doesn't have to use us. But He did and He does. Think about this. Before you were ever in your mother's womb, God already knew you, knew everything about you, and at that point in time, chose to love you. Just think about that. Before the universe was ever created, God knew everything about you, everything there was to know, and said, I love you. God doesn't have to use you to preach His word. Did you know that? God can save people any way He pleases. But He has chosen the vessel of us. He has chosen us as His vessels to proclaim the word. So number one, God didn't have to create you, but He did. Number two, God didn't have to love you, but the Bible tells us before you were ever in your mother's womb, He chose to love you from eternity past. God didn't have to save you, but He did. And He's wanting to save other people. And God doesn't have to use us to proclaim His message, but He does. So if any one of us ever think that preaching and evangelizing is an obligation we have to do, God could do it Himself. This is a blessing that God is sharing with us to meet other people's needs, to help other people where they are. God is choosing to use us. The question is, are we going to let God use us? Are we going to experience the blessing of seeing someone transform their lives? Are we going to see the blessing of seeing God, that is to say, God transforming the life of another person? That's the question. Man, I got to move on. Good night. It's almost 9:30. All right, so salvation. All right. We don't want to be like the people on the Titanic. You remember the people on the Titanic? They didn't have enough lifeboats to take everyone. Well, actually, they did have enough lifeboats. They just didn't use all of them, and they wasted their resources. In the end, they didn't save as many people as they could. We need to be sharing the gospel. Number three, the believer has the power of defense in verses 13 through 16. Now, notice when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, they proceed. Now again, I want to make this clear, because there's some archaeological evidence to back this up. They have found Peter's house. They have found the house of Peter in Capernaum. Actually, it was his mother-in-law's house. Some people say Peter wasn't married, but it's hard to have a mother-in-law if you're not married. I haven't figured that one out. You got to be married to have a mother-in-law. But her house sat very close to the synagogue, which means that Peter was no dummy. Peter was very influential in the society, and they had a close connection to the synagogue. Well, let me just leave that right there and move on. But we see, notice they said they're asking, they didn't go to their approved schools, and seeing the man who had been healed standing with them, they could say nothing against this, but they were asking, by whose authority you do this? What I'm simply trying to say is that Christianity has a defense. We can defend the truths of Christ because Christianity is the only one that can offer any positive evidence for its cause. Now, a lot of other worldviews will dismiss other worldviews by saying, well, Christians are goofy because they have this belief. And some other people will say, well, Christians do this or Christians do that. Only Christianity has positive evidence for its case to back up what it says. And if you don't believe me, look at the miracles that God has done and that He continues to do. It's an amazing thing with Jesus, an amazing thing with the apostles, that in the moment when people start denying and refusing, God does something spectacular to prove otherwise. Only Christianity has that ability. Now, the same Peter who defended the faith against the accusations of the religious leaders was the same one who said in 1 Peter 3:15 through 17, "In your hearts regard Christ the Lord as holy. Be ready at any time to give a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is within you. Be ready to answer anyone at any time what it is you believe and why it is you believe that." That's what he's talking about. But does this mean that we need to be argumentative? Does this mean that we need to be hostile? No, look what he says. "Yet do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience, so that when you are accused, those who disparage your good conduct in Christ will be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, than for doing evil." Did you catch that? Peter was most likely writing this while in a jail cell, or close to the time of being in a jail cell, awaiting his death. He knew that his time was coming close. His time of departure was at hand. When the time comes, will we stand ready, giving a defense for the hope that is within us? Lastly, the believer has the power of boldness. In verses 17 through 22, "But so it spreads no further among the people." Look what they're doing. They're threatening them. They first of all say, "Well, you better stop it," and they didn't listen. Well, what's the next thing? "Well, you better stop it, or we're gonna put you in prison." Well, that didn't stop them. "Well, you better stop them, or we're gonna hurt you." And they say, "Ha! Jesus defeated death. How are you gonna beat that, buddy?" So there's no stopping these guys. They are on a mission from God, and there's no talking them out of it. In verses 17 through 22, the religious leaders wanted to punish them, but they wouldn't relinquish. They would not quit. The Bible tells us that the believer should pursue peace as is possible. We should live in peace and harmony. However, if it comes to the gospel of Christ and people are trying to silence us, we are to keep on preaching regardless what may come to us, because what man intends for evil, God intends for good. And we see that in this passage of Scripture, some 5,000 men came to faith. By the time you count women and children, that may skyrocket even more. There is a number of people who came to faith by their bold preaching. The question is, do we have that boldness today? Do we have the boldness to go forth and tell people about Jesus Christ? And furthermore, if we are thrown into a court of law, we must ask ourselves a question. Do we have enough evidence to convict us of being a Christian? If they were to look at our lives and they were to look at our testimony, would there be enough evidence to convict us of being a Christian? Hopefully we'll not be faced with the same circumstances that the early disciples were. But understand and rest assured that we have the same power and authority that they did 2,000 years ago, because we serve the same Christ, we're filled with the same Holy Spirit, and we're on the same mission that they were 2,000 years ago. Kenneth Gangle, I'll close with this, tells the story of how a few years ago he was on the roster of speakers for the annual Moody's Founders Week. The music program was led by Pastor Jim Reese from Canada. And just before that conference, Pastor Reese's mentally challenged son celebrated his 10th birthday, for which his father had written a song. He sang it during that week, and the song went like this: "Bloom where you are planted, God's sun still shines above. Bloom where you are planted. He showers you with love. Weeds may grow and winds may blow, but keep your head up high. And bloom where you are planted. Keep growing toward the sky. You see, a lot of times we try to look for the next bigger and better thing. But I think the challenge we all have is to bloom where God has planted us. You see, a lot of times it's easy, and I'm all for foreign missions. Believe you me, that's why I'm a Southern Baptist. I believe in foreign missions. But understand, the mission field begins at home. First, your first mission field is to your family. Your second mission field is to your neighbors and to your community. It's an amazing thing that we can spend all this money to send missionaries afar and abroad, but we won't go next door to talk to our next door neighbors. Amen? We won't go into our communities and serve our communities and help in our communities. You see, the reality is we have the power and ability to see great things happen because of the risen King working through our lives. But the question is, do we have the willingness to evangelize? Are we willing to invest our lives in the lives of others? Are we willing to reach people for the cause of Christ? And that doesn't necessarily mean in large group gatherings. Sometimes it means discipleship. Investing in the life of someone, sharing the gospel through your lifestyle, sharing the gospel through your friendship, sharing the gospel through your love, and letting them know where you stand with Christ, and always being ready to be there for them, and always being ready to give a defense for the hope that you have within you. So with every head bowed and every eye closed, we have the power and the ability, but I want you to ask yourself this morning, do I have the willingness to share the gospel with others? I want to share one more thing with you before we pray. A lot of churches that have seen massive growth hasn't come from the pastors. Hasn't come from the pastors. What it's come from is by the people of the church being thrilled with the gospel, being filled with the Spirit of God, and by 10 people going out and witnessing to 2 people and bringing them back in a church, you'd see exponential growth if that continued like that. In fact, I know of a church that grew from a few hundred to several thousand by that very thing. Some people were trained to evangelize, and those people went out. 10 people were trained. They went out and they shared the gospel. Those 10 people in the church went out and shared the gospel, and they started seeing souls get saved. Those people came into the church, and you know what? The church naturally grew. It's simple mathematics. So are we called? We're all called to evangelize. We're all called to share the gospel of Christ. We have the power, we have the ability, but do we have the willingness? Dear kind and gracious Heavenly Father, in this time of invitation today, Lord, I want you to help every single person here today know that they are called to do a great work. That they have neighbors, they have family, they have friends, that they can reach. Because they have the authority, your authority, to go reach them. They have the ability given to them by your Holy Spirit to go share the gospel message. But Lord, the only thing that holds all of us back is the willingness to share the message of truth. So Lord, if there's someone here today that knows you not, I pray that today would be the day that they would come to receive you as Savior and Lord. But maybe there's someone here today, Lord, maybe you're calling them to go reach a certain person. And maybe that person just needs to come and resubmit their lives to you and to lay it all on the line, Lord, to say, wherever you send me, I will go. Whatever you call me to do, I'll do. Or maybe there's someone here today who has someone they're wanting to pray for. And maybe they just want to lay that person's name at the foot of your cross. Whatever the case is, Lord, we just pray that you'd have your will and your way in this time of invitation. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Would you please stand as we sing our final selection?